Hello everyone and welcome back to the Keep Productive YouTube channel. Today I have Ali back again.
Hello.
Ali does an amazing YouTube channel dedicated to students and also the medical industry as well, because you're a junior doctor as well.
I'm a junior doctor, yeah. Yeah. I work in Cambridge and I make videos about life as a doctor, but also about like study tips for students. And also tech reviews, if you're into that sort of thing.
Yeah, so it's a really good channel. Definitely recommend. I've been a fan for a while.
Thank you.
So it's good actually meeting you in person.
Oh, likewise.
And you did a great Google Sheets video. So if somebody wants to go deep in Google Sheets, you can understand how Ali uses that. We've just finished filming a Notion one as well. I'll include that one in the description. But now it's just got a good opportunity to chat to you about student productivity.
Because, yeah, my favorite topic.
Yeah, yeah.
That's one of your favorite topics as well.
Yeah, when I was a student, yeah. It was really important. I think like when you're a student, it's like taking advantage of all that time that you've got, and you're clearly someone who's already has done that. So my first question for you is about apps. Like what apps, maybe the core sort of apps you used at university to really master your time?
So core apps, I think once I got the iPad Pro in 2017, or like 2018, whatever, then Notability was the one I used to take handwritten notes in lectures. Before that point, I'd take handwritten notes on pen and paper, and then I would scan them into OneNote.
Okay.
And I found that taking handwritten notes was useful because there's a bit of evidence about why it's better than typed up notes, because it makes you engage a bit more. But also with handwritten notes, it meant I was actually staying awake in the lecture.
So, yeah.
So those were the note-taking apps that I used. And I also made extensive use of Anki, which is a flashcard app for memorizing things like, you know, the mechanism of action of various different drugs.
Yeah.
The sort of stuff that lends itself very nicely to putting into a flashcard and just being able to bash through them.
Yeah, definitely. And is there any more apps that you used in terms of like calendar apps? Or I know you're not too much of a to-do list app fan, but you went about using things for a while, right?
Yeah, so I used Forest quite a bit, which is a Pomodoro timer, you know, 25 minutes on and then 5 minutes break, and then, you know, you repeat the process. So that was quite good for studying with friends. I used Google Sheets quite a lot. I made some videos about it. I used it sort of as a flashcard replacement for some of my exams, but also as a kind of retrospective revision timetable where I would keep a log of what I'd studied and then color code it depending on how well I knew it. So then every day I'd be asking myself, what do I know the least? And I'd be looking at my timetable. And so instead of planning out my studies in advance, I'd be planning it out each day, thinking, what's my worst subject? Why don't I do that? So Google Sheets was quite good for that. Yeah. And then otherwise, I think, you know, fantastical for calendars, but I wouldn't really recommend that for students, because it's a bit expensive. It's a bit pricey. And things like Lightroom and Photoshop and the whole Adobe Creative Cloud, essentially, to,
lovely.
Get stuff done.
Yeah, and obviously apps are really fantastic as part of a sort of suite for getting things done. But we've just done a feature on your channel.
We have.
All about productivity apps.
We have. So well, if we take a deep dive into
six whole categories.
Apps.
It was mad.
Absolutely mental.
And we talked a little bit there about like general tips. Like, do you have some? Obviously, the Pomodoro technique has been something that's really benefited you, right?
Yeah, so the Pomodoro technique was quite nice. I don't personally use it that much anymore because I don't really have problems with focusing for 40 minutes at a time. But especially earlier on in my undergrad career and when I was working with friends, some of whom did have problems with focusing for more than 25 minutes, it was a really nice like group study technique where we'd all get together in the library, we'd start our timer together, we'd be working for 25 minutes, and then we'd have a 5 minute break together where we're just chatting or sending links. You know, that was before the days of sending memes to one another.
Yeah.
And we just repeat this process. So that was good and good for that.
In terms of studying in general, like, is there any other techniques that helped you or people around you to get things done?
Oh God, yeah. So in our second year, we had a really great lecture from experimental psychology about how to study for exams, the evidence behind it. And all of us in the year group, we were just completely mind blown by how inefficiently we'd been studying for our whole lives up to that point, and how we pretty much got into Cambridge by just, you know, a combination of good luck and natural intelligence and not really having to work too hard for exams.
Yeah.
Whereas once you're at Cambridge and the exams are really, really, really hard, we were like, oh my God, this is incredible. And there were techniques like active recall, which is just about testing yourself, retrieving information from your brain as a method of strengthening those connections, but also spaced repetition, which is how the idea that over time you very quickly forget everything that you've ever learned unless you repeat your recall of that subject. But so, for example, let's say I learned something today, I'd repeat it a day later and then a week later, and then a month later.
Yeah.
And apps like Anki and Quizlet have this sort of algorithm built into them, so you can use spaced repetition effectively. So active recall and spaced repetition were the number one and number two study efficiently techniques.
Yeah, they. I can imagine they help deliver good results.
Yeah, completely change the game.
Yeah, that's it. And obviously, like, you've been someone that has taken... Not just being, because obviously at university and in college, you a lot of the time, like, people just do the course and come out and they're very much, they've got the course, but they're not necessarily have a competitive advantage against other such students applying for jobs and things like that. Obviously, you did quite a lot at university. The YouTube has obviously taken you a lot further. So is there any advice you'd give for people about being proactive or like taking yourself outside of your comfort zone?
Yeah, I think so. So there's, I don't like the whole idea of competition as such. Like, I kind of like doing this thing. I think Peter Thiel says it in Zero to One, where you kind of define your own category.
Mm.
Like, I'm not at all interested in competing with people to try and get to that number one professor spot in Cambridge.
Yeah.
Because the amount of effort you have to put in and the amount of competition there is to my mind, not worth it. Because I want to be doing other things with my time.
Yeah.
So my whole philosophy from quite early on has been that I want to carve out a unique career path for myself so that I'm the only one in my category rather than trying to be the best in a pre-existing category. So for me, it would be things like combining my love of medicine with my love of coding, with my love of like graphic design and web design. And hopefully, I think the YouTube channel was a good amalgamation of this because a big part of it is medicine. A big part of it is kind of going really nerdy deep dives into things like the evidence behind effective study techniques. It's kind of like how you do deep dives on your channel about these apps.
Yeah.
But also combines good production value, hopefully, a sense of graphic design. All of these things create a hopefully more unique sort of career path than, you know, just being a doctor and trying to work my way up the ranks.
I quite like that. The fact that you haven't, like, the default is, I'm against you, you're against me, like I just said.
Yeah.
And that's quite nice. I've not really heard, like, a take like that before. So
the whole
that is really nice. I think that's of good value because I think these days students are, like, constantly bombarded at where they should go. And actually just, like, creating your own path is probably the best way to go.
I mean, there is then the counter argument that my mum sometimes tells me is that, oh, you know, I'm only saying this because I'm scared of competition or because I'm shying away from a challenge. And there may be some element to that, but to be honest, you know, I'd rather have a more balanced life. Even if I am shying away from a challenge, I don't care. You know, I don't want to compete with Usain Bolt in the 100 meters. I'd rather be pretty reasonably good at various different things because it's just a bit more fun.
Yeah, oh, I agree with that. That's good advice. Thank you so much for coming on, Ali. And if you haven't yet watched, go on and find out how Ali uses Notion because you'll start to get a good idea of how you can apply that to student life. And pretty much organizing different aspects, like you used it for being able to obviously take notes that inspire you across the day. So it's fantastic. Thanks for coming on, man.
No, thanks for having me. Yeah, it's been a pleasure.
It's been awesome. Right. Yeah.
See you later.
Fantastic.
Bye, guys.
We're going to have some lunch, right?
We're going to have some food, yeah.
Yeah.
It'll be good. Yeah.
Lovely. Thanks, guys. Make sure to subscribe, like the video, and make sure to join Ali's channel too. Thanks very much. See you soon.
Bye-bye.
Bye.